You know, the lyrics of this song, I don't care who sings it. I think, you know, some of the greatest lyrics
absolutely
ever produced.
Yeah, this was George McGovern's walk. This was during the Vietnam War. The theme of that, McGovern was the anti-war, and he was going to be the bridge over troubled waters. He failed to get elected, unfortunately.
Welcome back to a Friday edition of the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's let's go to the phone lines. And Mike from Kenosha has been hanging out. Mike, thank you for hanging on. You say what?
Well, thank you for taking my call, as always. Happy Friday to everybody. You know, I was very much eager to see or listen to what Trump had to say at this major news conference.
You mean yesterday? You mean yesterday, right?
Right, and I, you know, I love to hear that stuff. I'm very much interested in what he has to say. But I thought to myself, while he's explaining how difficult it is for families to make ends meet and the price of eggs and milk and how families are struggling with, you know, economic insecurity, in the front of an exclusive Westminster country club that costs, you know, six digits just to join. And I thought to myself, who in the world, of all places, I mean, wouldn't you pick a soup kitchen or, you know, in front of a Goodwill store? But of all places, he picked Westminster.
No, Bedminster.
Bedminster, thank you.
Yeah.
And I asked myself why. And there's only one answer I could come up with. It made sense. That way he could charge his campaign and bill it to Bedminster. So it was a profit center.
Yeah.
I mean, how in the world could you pick that kind of a and it's all full of lies, you know, 10% mortgage rates. I mean, I don't know who's feeding him the numbers, but he was sure pitching them. But of all the places to pick, I just thought that was as big of a gaffe as I've seen in a long, long time. I want to get your opinion on that.
Well, I think Donald Trump is so far out of touch with common people, right? The people who actually have these issues and have to deal with it. He wants to talk about them, but he has no sense of them. He's never been amongst them. It's a distant projection of his mind if he would ever try to empathize or project. So that's why he does these things. I'm confident that he picks Bedminster because all the press have to pay to get there. I'm sure there was a significant dollar flow to Bedminster as the result of that he could delight in. But furthermore, when you listen to what he had to say, it was comical. I mean, he had a lot of groceries out in front of him to point at, things he probably never eats, cornflakes, and I don't know.
Well, he said he's going to take some Cheerios home and do something with the Cheerios.
Yeah. Then he devolved quickly from actual economic policy.
The name calling.
One point he said, it was like he was talking to his campaign staff who must have said, can't you stop the name calling? And so he, at the press conference, he says, I'm entitled to do name calling. I'm entitled to do this. And then he launches off into the process. Like I said, I think this is a one joke comedian. It's a one act play, and it's the same act. That's who he is. He can't change it. I'm not sure that it's devolved. I think this is the act that he brought forth for a long time. In the beginning, it seemed like this was Mr. Outside, and he was going to come into Washington, all those who wanted an outsider to come into Washington and break down the beltway and bring something closer to the people into Washington. But that isn't who this person is. He is simply an iconoclast. He is simply a person who is not the norm, okay? But his version of not normal is not something that's close to Tom, Dick, and Mary.
So let me ask both you guys. He can't expand his base. His base is what it is. His base alone can't get him elected. What is he saying or doing that is going to expand what he needs to get elected?
I think he thinks he can tear down the opposition. It's not like expanding him. It's like diminishing someone else, which will, he think, inflate his position. I think the person he has to seriously worry about is Tim Walz, because I think Tim Walz does appeal to his base, okay? I think Tim Walz understands his base. I think Tim Walz comes from a place that was inhabited by many people who are currently fans of Donald Trump. And I think we're going to find over the period of this campaign that Tim Walz is a person who really speaks to a lot of people that Donald Trump thought he had his thumb on.
Well, I thought they said that J.D. Vance was the guy who could speak to those people.
I thought that Tim Walz handled that very well by saying, I come from the country, I come from the farmland. He said, well, all my friends went to Yale.
Mike, you want to respond?
Well, yeah, I think, you know, I don't like it when we're played, when the media is played or the public are played with this major announcement, and all it was gaslighting and grievance. I don't like that at all, and I think we can deal with that in some type of regulatory fashion in the future. But otherwise, you know, keep the cameras rolling. You know, it's right in front of America and the world for all to see. You know, the good will prevail overall.
Hey, Mike, thank you. Thank you very much for the call. Really appreciate it. Let's go to Cassandra from Madison. Good morning to Cassandra. You say what?
Hi, Earl and Sandy. Have you all been able to read Harris's economic plan? Some of the news media have posted highlights of her economic plan. And Sandy, I just have one question for you, because I believe you said you were an economist. Is that correct?
Well, I'm an economist. I never was a professional economist. That was what I studied in school. But yeah, go ahead.
Okay. All right. One portion of her platform is that she wants to control prices for groceries. And the way she is going to do that would be empowering the Federal Trade Commission and state attorneys to investigate corporations and to penalize them. Now, what I recall, Nixon issued an executive order for price controls. But my question is, in order to control the price, don't you also have to control wages?
Let me say, I don't think that what she's recommending is price control. I think that's what the people who are already coming off the wall to oppose whatever she's saying have described it as. I think what she's talking about is pursuing large grocery chains for the process of having non-competitive prices. Okay, the FTC is an organization that looks at unfair trade practices and anti-competitive trade practices. And that's the same power that attorneys general would have associated with it, U.S. attorneys would have. So what they're looking at is pursuing and enlivening the antitrust laws to make sure that big grocery chains are not exercising market power by raising prices rapidly and having prices fall slowly in the face of falling commodity prices. And so that's different. That's more about looking at whether there are monopoly profits being earned and using the government's power with respect to monopolies to affect pricing that might be the result of monopoly power price gouging. I think that's what she's talking about. She's not talking about telling them what they can charge for cornflakes or whether they can increase the price of cornflakes less than the cost of cornflakes that they're paying to the distributor. I think it's something different than that. So I think we ought to wait for the details. I don't think the campaign has released the details of exactly how it operates. But from what they have released, it looks to me like they're looking at simply implementing the antitrust and fair trade practices powers of the FTC to exercise muscle against those who are, you know, the fact is that during this last round of price increases, the profit level for the grocery chains went up enormously. And that shouldn't happen in a competitive environment. The markup for goods shouldn't go up because of scarcity, because competition should keep people shaving their margins to make sure that they can continue to beat the competition.
So, Cassandra, let me ask you, the fact that she's attempting to address the issue, does that carry some merit? I mean, what has transpired here is out of control and not beneficial to the average everyday person. It's a major issue. Shouldn't she attempt to rectify the problem?
Earl, I'm not saying she shouldn't try it. I was just trying to understand how price controls work, because a factor that is driving up the prices is the cost of labor. So if you're going to, in some way, make the prices more competitive, you also have to work on wages as well.
I don't think this is price control. I think that every economist would agree that price controls don't work unless you actually have a national emergency of the level of, for instance, World War II. And there they didn't go to price controls. They actually went to rationing as the solution. But I don't think she's not talking about price control. And so I don't think that she's going to try and throttle wage increases, and I don't think wage increases could possibly be laid. I don't think the increase in prices that we've recently experienced at the grocery store could possibly be laid to the feet of wage increases.
Cassandra, thank you very much for the call, as always. 844-967-2789 is Friday. That means Fridays with my co-host Sandy Williams and you. I don't know who that is. What is his name?
Bachman Turner.
Bachman Turner Overdrive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is the Al Gore walkout.
Yeah.
You ain't seen nothing
you
yet.
You ain't seen nothing yet. Yeah. Yeah, I knew I remember that. Anyway, welcome back. 844. Did they make any other hits?
Yeah.
All right, 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Friday. That means Fridays with my co-host Sandy Williams and you. You know, Sandy, I wanted to follow up on what Cassandra was asking, you know, about whether or not Kamala Harris could, you know, do something to address the issues with the cost. And Cassandra mentioned about the labor costs, and that may be one of the reasons why,
well,
you know, this jump out of, you know, the cost of this was due to labor costs. And I don't know of anybody that would say who works in grocery stores that they got some gigantic raises.
Well, I mean, I think the thing is that the Republicans who have heard this now today have immediately wanted to figure out what can they say that is in opposition to what she's talking about. So she's talking about trying to limit the capacity of grocers to charge exorbitant profits because of market power, which is an antitrust kind of a fair trade issue. And the opponents want to call it price controls, okay? And price controls are very troublesome. They're very hard to implement. And if you put price controls on the economy, and you tell people they can't charge more for a product, Well, they're going to start saying, well, you know, but we can't give wage increases underneath that price then, because that'll just be squeezing us out of business. And it is true that Nixon attempted to impose price controls in the 70s, and it did result in a lot of complexities in the labor market and elsewhere. But this isn't a situation where labor cost has contributed materially to the price of groceries. That isn't the problem with the price of groceries. What the problem has been upon analysis is that the price of groceries went up rapidly during a period of rising prices and rising commodity prices, and they didn't come down anywhere near as rapidly when the underlying commodity prices went down. And as a result, grocery chains earned very high profits. That profit, when prices don't react as they should in a competitive market by following costs, that's called market power. That's called the result of either oligopoly or monopoly market power. That's the stuff that the FTC and antitrust laws are used to limit the capacity for price gouging. Okay, price gouging, if you looked at it from an economic standpoint, would be the kind of price you can charge because you have market power, because there is a monopoly problem in the marketplace that needs to be addressed. And the only people that can address that are either plaintiff's attorneys on behalf of customers or the government.
So
she's proposing a very sensible approach, which is she's going to enliven the federal government's capacity to take on these kinds of market power issues to try and limit the extent to which grocery chains charge excessive prices.
So let me ask you then, Sandy. So Congress doesn't have any tools or any involvement in this whatsoever? Only the president can step forward? I mean, Congress controls.
No, well, Congress,
they set the laws.
I know, the laws are determined. But the marketplace, I mean, we have a market economy. And the marketplace decides what the price is going to be by measuring by itself ongoing on an organic basis, having the demand and supply go into equilibrium by the price that's set for them. And if there's a shortage of something, the price of it will go up. And if there's a surplus of something, the price of it will go down. And that's what the market does. And the market decides how many widgets we make and how many Chevrolets we make and how many apples get produced. You know, the market is out there deciding all this.
But there was no shortage of food.
I know, but there were shortages, actually, during the period.
COVID. Yeah.
During COVID, and there were shortages, and that contributed materially to the rise in prices of food. That's why food went up faster in price one of the reasons why it went up or could have gone up faster in price than inflation, because the shortages would drive it up. So when oranges get rare when there's a big frost in Florida and the oranges don't get produced, the price goes up and the marketplace price goes up.
When the bird flu, they have slaughtered a lot of chickens
and
turkeys.
Chickens and the eggs got scarce. Yeah, eggs go up. So that's all what the market does. We don't want the U.S. Senate and Congress to try and play with pricing in the marketplace, other than this question of monopoly power causing price gouging. And it's something that has gone on. That's one of the reasons we had rationing during World War II. There was the potential for massive price gouging with shortages. But Kamala is not going all the way to the point of recommending price controls here. She's simply talking about trying to exercise the power the government does have to relate to monopoly pricing.
All right. Labor costs, these are some Texas. Labor costs have remained more or less static in the manufacturing space that I work in. It seems to be simply increased demands from shareholders for more and more returns on investments. Good job, Sandy. Great explanation. The current administration is already dealing with the topic by looking at junk fees airlines charging for flight changes. Due to weather, et cetera. So Sandy, if what about this? Labor costs have remained more or less static in the manufacturing space that I work in. It seems to be simply increased demands from shareholders for more and more returns on investment. What about that?
Well, I think each company should chase profits. I mean, that's what a business is trying to do, is to be successful. and to achieve in a legitimate way, in a moral way, in a marketly,
but who
in a market
that
ethics.
From greed? Where is that line?
Well, the marketplace, if it's operating, if you have a competitive marketplace, you can't exercise greed because somebody else comes along and says,
I can do it cheaper.
I can do it cheaper, and I will do it cheaper, and so don't pay that price, pay my price. And that's what the discipline of the market does. That's what keeps people from being able to charge excessive prices to earn excessive profits. And the definition of excessive is the kind of profit you can earn if you don't have a competitive market.
But if you got a monopoly, like the grocery stores.
Well, what's happened is increasingly, ever since Ronald Reagan, our country has kind of fallen asleep with respect to its enforcement of its antitrust laws. And there's been a great deal of consolidation in all kinds of markets. Look at the medical industry, the consolidation of hospitals. Well, the same thing has happened in the grocery industry. There's fewer and fewer national grocery grocers. And as you get smaller in number, it gets better. It gets easier for them to have an impact on the price that's different than what a competitive market price would set.
All right. 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Friday. My co-host, Sandy Williams, and you. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's Friday. That means Friday's my co-host, Sandy Williams, and you. I'm now joined by Miss Chiquita Brooks-LaSure. And I'm sorry, ma'am, I forgot your title.
No problem. Good morning. It's Chiquita Brooks-LaSure, and I am the administrator of the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services.
Yes, ma'am. It is so great to have you on, and you are here to talk about a subject that Sandy and I, my co-hosts, were talking about earlier, and that's this really exciting news about what Joe Biden and Kamala Harris have been able to do with addressing these 10 medications that have been a eyesore and causing all sorts of pain to the American people.
You are absolutely right. We are so excited that President Biden and Vice President Harris have finally been able to do what people have been trying to do for decades, which is really give Medicare the power to negotiate drug prices for the millions of Americans that rely on the Medicare program. And I'm just so excited to be able to share what we were able to accomplish thanks to their work to make sure that everybody in this country has more affordable health care. We, as I said, were able to, for the first time, negotiate on behalf of Medicare beneficiaries. And the top 10 drugs, in terms of how many people take them or how expensive they are, we negotiated lower prices for people and for the Medicare program so that the Medicare program will be here for our children as well as our children's children. This is a multi-generational thing. So
let me ask you how they were able to make this happen after all of this time. Clearly, they didn't do it unilaterally. They were able to do this with bipartisan support. No bipartisan support?
No, they had authorization to negotiate, and so they had to sit across the table, I believe, from the pharma and work this out. So, I take it this is the beginning, right? There are more drugs and different arrangements that might be made going forward.
You are right that this is just the beginning. And to answer your question, how are we able to do this for the first time? The president and the vice president were able to get this passed through Congress just 2 years ago, and it was a really exciting day. There are more benefits, which I'll talk about in just a minute, in addition to drug negotiation. But the vice president was the tie-breaking vote in the Senate to get this passed, and we now have the authority, we're in that law, we're given the authority to negotiate for the first time. And over the last couple of months, we've been sitting across the table from drug companies, just as you're saying, to get a better deal. And we did. We were able to lower prices about 40 to 80% off of the list price or the public prices. The savings that we've been able to generate from negotiation will equal about $1.5 billion to Medicare recipients in 1 year alone. And these drug negotiated prices will take effect in 2026.
So I was never able to understand, Ms. Brooks, why they were able, pharmaceutical companies were able to utilize the tax dollars of the American people to create many of these drugs and then charge a much lower price nationally and internationally than they were able to charge the people here at home whose tax dollars they used to produce the drug in the first place.
Well, when Medicare first started covering drugs, the law explicitly said that Medicare could not negotiate directly for the price of drugs. And that's why it's taken so long for us to be able to be in a position to deliver these savings. President Biden said yesterday that he introduced legislation when he was in Congress to negotiate in 1973. I mean, that's how long this has been an issue for Medicare beneficiaries to be able to not be able for the government to be able to negotiate.
So this bipartisan bill that passed 2 years ago that allowed negotiation was really Congress finally overcoming the power of the big pharma lobbyists to get the power back from what they had to give up when it was passed in the first place, right?
It actually was not bipartisan, but yes, it was the act of Congress passing the legislation. And again, the vice president had to be the tie-breaking vote for the legislation to move forward, in fact, because it was not bipartisan.
I see. All right. But in other words, it was finally, I mean, what was happening, I presume, was that big pharma's lobbyists were resisting any legislative change that would have given the government the power to do this negotiation.
Often you see that when it is very difficult to pass legislation, that there is a lot of lobbying here in D.C. And so this is a tremendous, you can just see what a tremendous change, how historic this is. And I think one of the things I just am so happy about, and I know we all are, when you think about the drugs that we're talking about, it's almost everybody in this country is touched by this. Earlier this week, I heard just heartbreaking stories and also stories full of hope from people who are reliant on insulin and are now benefiting from the $35 a month cap on each covered insulin by the Medicare program. I heard from doctors about how there are fewer people coming to the ER now who from diabetic reactions and comas because insulin is now capped at $35 a month for Medicare. Next year, everybody who is covered by the Medicare program and enrolled in our prescription drug coverage will benefit from a $2,000 cap on their prescription drug costs. And people are relieved that they no longer have to worry about whether or not they should retire, that their drug costs, most of the people who take these 10 drugs have well over $2,000 in drug costs during the course of the year.
You know, Ms. Brooks-LaSure, I'm one of them. And I will say to you that, as you stated before, all of us know somebody or have somebody we love who this impacts tremendously because of the sheer price of, you know, a lot of these different drugs deal with heart ailments, diabetes,
yes,
and diseases that impact and affect the elderly. And so it's the elderly, for the most part, who can't afford many of these drugs. And that's been what I think has been so egregious of these policies, that for so long, my parents, who are no longer here, had to go through that and struggle with that. Now here I am in my 70s. And the fact that we've finally been able to make some movement, I think that's something to celebrate.
I think you are so right. And thank you for sharing that you are a person. So many of our parents, ourselves, I mean, the average person, the average senior in this country is on seven or more drugs, and they can be extremely expensive. The 10 drugs that we negotiated for some of the most common ailments in our country, things like diabetes, cardiovascular disease. Most seniors in this country, one in three Medicare beneficiaries has diabetes. These are very common conditions, and then some of them are not common, and when you get them, you need them. Like cancer, you need your cancer medication. And so I'm so excited to be able to share the work that we've been able to do in the agency and just how much President Biden and Vice President Harris are committed to making healthcare more affordable for not just seniors, but everyone in this country.
So I think one of the things that you just stated that is so critically important for people here, especially right now, when you hear the other side of this coin wanting to talk about negative things associated with Kamala Harris and President Biden, and trying to say, well, you know, you were in the room and you were part of all of these different negative things, but this great thing that is just happening, you won't hear them wanting to give any credit at all to Vice President Kamala Harris. But this is something that they have done together and collectively, and she should be able to accept the credit as well as he for this. Is it safe to say that?
It is more than safe to say that. She, the vice president, was the tie-breaking vote. I have traveled with her across this country as she has shaken the hands and talked to people who have benefited from the cap on insulin, who have benefited from hearing about the first time ever cap in the Medicare program on prescription drugs, and has been so committed to addressing healthcare costs. As Attorney General, she took on the pharmaceutical industry to try to make sure that coverage and healthcare are more affordable. And she, just like the president, are so committed to healthcare. They have done, we could go on and on about how committed they have been to try to make sure that people have access to care, because we have the most innovative drugs in the world, just as you said at the beginning of our conversation. But if people don't actually have access to them, it's meaningless.
I mean, that's, I think, one of the healthcare travesties of our country is we have the most sophisticated healthcare in the world, and yet the access to it for the American public has been, for a variety of reasons, not so very great. And the record we have with respect to the usage of our medical system by everybody in the country is not one that we should be very proud of. So I think what's really great here is the fact that here we have a demonstrable situation where politically in Washington. We have we had leadership that stood up against a lobby like the Big Pharma lobby and won something, because I think one of the frustrating things for the American public is the extent to which all this money in Washington that's spread around by various of the interest groups seems to succeed in the face of the public interest. And here's a circumstance where the opposite happened, where the public interest prevailed in spite of what must have been a very difficult political battle that related to the lobby of Big Pharma.
You are so right to celebrate that this is one of the few examples, but what an important example of really being able to make sure that we could deliver for people despite just so much resistance and continued opposition. And I think that's the thing to remember, that people really have to say that they care about this benefit. There are people who might try to take that away. And I think that we are so pleased that we've been able to implement this law.
Thank you so very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule. We hope to hear more from you as the campaign moves forward.
Thank you. Have a great day.
You as well. You're tuned into the Earl Ingram Show. Hang on, Al. 844-967-2789 is the number. Who is this, Obama?
John Kerry.
Really?
Yeah.
Music is a world within itself. With a language, you know, those guys, Mondale, what's the other guy you said?
Well, Dukakis.
Dukakis, and now?
John Kerry.
John Kerry. Man, I almost forgot about those guys.
That's what I said. Dukakis is someone who I'm sure is going to be a trivia answer that everyone won't get at some point. You know, he went down in flames pretty quickly and quietly.
You remember John Anderson? Not John.
Well, I do remember John Anderson because the governor of Wisconsin that I worked for, Pat Lucey, was the vice presidential candidate under John Anderson. And he's the reason why Jimmy Carter lost his reelection bid.
All right. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. Sandy, we've got some texts. I was just about to mention that it's ridiculous that a few companies control nearly all of the grocery stores in the U.S. There needs to be more than a handful of companies in these spaces that everyone interacts with for the free market to work, or leads to price fixing. Are these drugs paid for by the federal government via Medicare, or are they paid for by the patients directly? Not a Medicare user yet, so not sure who pays for what. Most of the other countries negotiate with the companies to lower the prices with reason, or just ignore them. If the ask is too high, and the synthesize themselves.
Yeah, well, answered a couple of questions. When you're in Medicare, you're required to have a prescription drug coverage as well, but there's a self-pay portion of that, and so both the patient and the Medicare system pay for those drugs, and it's important that the price go down, not just for us on the patient side, but also that it goes down for the government, because that ultimately controls the cost, the overall cost of Medicare and the sustainability of Medicare, like the caller, the prior caller just mentioned. So, and with respect to the grocery chains, I mean, it's absolutely right. The consolidation of industry in this country has driven many, many important industries into a situation which could be called oligopoly, meaning that there are few, not one. Monopoly is just one man,
right.
One seller, but there are few sellers. And when there are few sellers, they're able to figure out how to play the market in a manner that creates something very close to monopoly pricing. And so we have, you can look around, all the industries, Boeing, the only airplane manufacturer, the beer industry is consolidated in terms of national brewers, just several of them, and they're international. Grocery chains, about four, and one of them, Aldi, is an international one. And are there many local competitors? Well, we used to have local competitors in Milwaukee. We had Kohl's, we had Sendix, we had a variety. It's really down to a very limited number of local competitors and a very limited number of national competitors. And the result is the result we're seeing, which is prices which don't behave very competitively.
All right, let's go to Robert from West Allis. Good morning to you, Robert. You say what?
Good morning. I just had a question on the votes. I don't know if that was mentioned or not. How did the people in Wisconsin vote? Was it they were in the House or the Senate? Was it right down party lines, or what was that voting like on lowering prices, or was this done through some type of administrative action?
No, the caller explained that. I had forgotten the fact that there was a bill that passed.
It wasn't bipartisan.
And she said it was not bipartisan, which suggests to me that probably the Wisconsin delegation voted on party lines and the Democrats voted for the power and the Republicans voted against it. I know that, you know, Big Pharma has this charming idea that they spin, which is that they need to spend lots of money on research and development to come up with all these fancy drugs that can solve all kinds of problems. And that therefore, I guess, their profits in the United States with respect to these products ought to be essentially unlimited. Because if the government can't negotiate the price and the government is their biggest customer, then the marketplace that's left to set the price is very, very small. And it's basically they can charge whatever price they can hold their head up about and not be totally ashamed about. And we can remember there was several years ago a young fellow who was in the process of being a dissident shareholder taking over some companies, and part of his strategy was to take over companies that were selling things like insulin and to quadruple their prices. We had the EpiPen scandal, for instance, that's the epinephrine pen that's given to people who have anaphylactic shock reactions for allergies, and the price of that went up like 100-fold just because it could.
But the folly in that, Sandy, is they're using the taxpayers' dollars.
Well, some of these drugs are developed under taxpayer dollars, and then they turn around and get huge.
And gouge the American people, yes. And they sell them cheaper overseas. How does that make any sense?
Well, I don't know. They spin this yarn about the need for profits to support their research. But to be honest with you, I think it's just a self-serving rationalization, and it's an idea that they can put in the pocket. They can put in the mind of the legislator who is otherwise putting in their pocket the campaign contributions from them through the lobbyists.
But Sandy, they can't do any of those things without the legislature creating an environment that makes it legal for them to do it.
Exactly. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about the lobbying industry working to the benefit of their special interest clients against the interest of the public. And they're providing to legislators a couple of things. One, the money needed to get reelected. And two, a rationale that they can try to sell the public about why it is that what they're doing is good public policy. And the rationale they're selling is we need essentially unlimited profits so we can invent new drugs. Invent new drugs for what? You know, ED problems? I mean, you know, no, I mean, the drug industry chases things that will be patented and things that will be high volume. And they don't chase things that cure diseases. They chase
right.
things that are to respond to chronic diseases that have a lifetime of demand.
Sandy, I'm sorry. That stinks to high heaven. I don't care how you cut it. Anyway, thanks, Sandy. Always great to have you on. Thank everybody who made the show go. Thank you, Calvin. Up next, Matt Nair on air, Greg Bach, Jane Matt Nair. Enjoy the weekend.